Trino masses, and then I arrived to the neutrinoless double beta decay that I will discuss today. But first, let me go one moment back to this slide where I showed what are the possibilities to. What are the possibilities for the different neutrino masses from what we know, namely from the observation of neutrino oscillations? And I forgot to remark here that, as you see clearly from these plots, both in the no normal ordering case or in the inverted ordering, we know for sure that two neutrinos have masses. So one could be massless. It is unlikely that it is massless if the other two are massive, but in principle it could be, or it can have a very small mass. But we know for sure that two neutrinos have a mass, and there is a lower limit for this mass, which is about 8 millielectron volts. And this is an important thing for the relic neutrinos that I will discuss later today. These are the relic neutrinos which remains from the Big Bang, so they were produced in the Big Bang. And we will see that the current temperature of relic neutrinos is about 10 to the minus 4 electron volts. So this means that the temperature is smaller than the mass of at least two neutrinos. So in present relic neutrinos, at least two of them are non-relativistic. Okay, then let me go to the discussion of neutrinoless double beta decay. I don't want to skip this because this is a very important process that can reveal the Majorana nature of neutrinos. And this is very important from not only for neutrinos, but for our concept of physics, because we don't know any other elementary particle which is a Majorana particle. So this will be a discovery if they discover neutrinoless double beta decay. This will be a major discovery in physics. Neutrinoless double beta decay can occur in nuclei which have this are in this situation in which some nucleus which cannot decay by single beta decay because the nucleus nearby has a bigger energy, but it can decay with a two simultaneous beta decay in a nucleus which is here, so which has a smaller energy with a difference of the number of two protons and two neutrons. But the total number of nucleons is the same. So this process is occurs for some, so this situation occurs for some nuclei. And this is a very difficult process to observe. There are two types of this neutrinoless, of this double beta decay. One is called the two neutrino double beta decay, and one is called the neutrinoless one. The two neutrino double beta decay is a process which can occur in the standard model because it is just a simultaneous two beta decays in the nucleus with emission of two neutrinos. So this is a standard process, a standard weak interaction process in the standard model. It is very rare because it is of second order in the Fermi constant. So it is suppressed, strongly suppressed, but it has been observed. So this is nothing new. I mean, not, it's an interesting process to observe, but it's not new physics. What we are interested is in the neutrinoless double beta decay, which is in which the two lines of the neutrino, instead of being emitted, they are joined to form a propagator. And then this is a diagram which is allowed only if neutrinos are Majorana particles, because you see that one antineutrino is emitted. If you reverse this line, it means that here a neutrino can be absorbed. So you can have this process only if neutrinos are Majorana particles. And moreover, you need also a chirality flip to join these two lines, so you need an effect of the neutrino mass. Yes, this is sufficient because higher order corrections are completely negligible. Yes. Already this is very small, so higher order corrections are really negligible. But in any case, the big problem, as I will maybe show later, is that the decay rate, so the decay rate is the inverse of the lifetime, is given by this effective neutrino Majorana mass, some phase space time term, and some nuclear matrix element. So this you need to calculate the transition between one nucleus and the other. So you need to calculate the nuclear matrix element from the transition with a heavy nuclei to another heavy nuclei. So this induces large uncertainties, and we will see in the following slide that the uncertainty is not a percentage, but it's a factor of two or three in the number total. So there is a large uncertainty, and in this situation it makes no sense to compute a radiative correction because the nuclear uncertainty is much larger. So here you note that if you want to calculate this process, you must sum over the propagators or all the massive neutrinos. So in the propagators, each propagator contributes with the mass of the massive neutrino, and then you have a two coefficient Uek here, which is, so you have the sum over Uek squared times the mass, and this gives the effective Majorana mass that determines this process. How you distinguish the two neutrino beta decay from the neutrino less double beta decay? By this property that when you emit the two neutrinos, then of course you never measure the neutrinos, you can measure the electrons. So you measure the electrons which are coming up from the energy of the electron which is coming up from the process. And you can measure the total sum of the energies of the two electrons. But in this process, also neutrinos are emitted, so some energy must go to the neutrino. This means that the spectrum of the total energy of the two electrons is a continuous spectrum, which ends at the Q value. But instead, in the neutrinoless case, all the energy goes to the electron. So the total energy of the electron is exactly equal to the Q value. And you have a peak here due to the neutrinoless double beta decay. So you must, if you observe a peak here at the Q value, this is a signal of neutrinoless double beta decay. So experiments are just focusing in this region. These are is very difficult experiments because the process is very rare. So the event rate is, so they have a huge amount of atoms, but the event rate is very small. There is background, and background is due to radioactivity, environment radioactivity, to cosmic rays, and also to the two neutrino beta decay, because here you have just at the end point of the spectrum, also you have some events due to the two neutrino beta decay. As I said before, the effective mass is given by this expression, and here there is a complication due to the fact that the elements of the mixing matrix, they are not modulo squared, but they are squared. And this can lead to an unpleasant situation because there can be, so these are complex numbers, so and you must sum complex numbers in the complex plane. And as you know, the absolute value of the sum of complex numbers is less than the sum of the absolute values because you can have cancellations. So unfortunately, even if the single contribution of the massive neutrino can be relatively large, you can have cancellations, and the effective Majorana mass can be very small. Here we can write the effective Majorana mass in this way, where there are the absolute values of the three elements of the mixing matrix, and there are some phases which are related to the phases in the mixing matrix. And in particular, you can see that this is the Dirac phase, and instead these two are the Majorana phases. So in this process, one can have an effect of the Majorana phases because this is a lepton number violating process. And here you can see some illustration of what can happen. So in this case, the sum of the three gives some mass, which is smaller than the sum of the absolute values. And the situation can be even so bad that if the three contribution are have some sides with some angles here, they can cancel exactly. So you can have the very unfortunate situation that even if neutrinos are Majorana particles, there is some conspiration of the masses and phases in such a way that you cannot observe neutrino-less double beta decay. This will be some sort of nightmare scenario for the people who are looking for this process. This is some summary of some results, which is not updated now. It was in 2015. You can see that there are many experiments which use different nuclei, and they measure the lifetime. Lifetimes are very large, of larger than 10 to the 20 years. From these lifetimes, they can obtain, so since they did not observe, so far this process has not been observed, they all put a lower bound on the lifetime, and this can be translated into an upper bound for the effective Majorana mass, that is the quantity which gives information on neutrino masses and the mixing. And you can see that here this bound corresponds to bounds which have an uncertainty of a factor of about 3. This is due to this problem that I discussed before of the calculation of the matrix, nuclear matrix element. So in order to extract the Majorana mass from the lifetime, you need to know the value of the nuclear matrix element, and this is badly known. This is also the similar picture in which shows the experimental bound, which is obtained with a different calculation of these calculations of these nuclear matrix elements. There are different nuclear methods, which is the nuclear shell model, the QRPA model, and other models, which, as you can see from the different points here, give different values for the nuclear matrix element. And it is difficult to understand which of this model calculation is correct. So the usual approach is to take as an uncertainty just the range which is given by the different models, and this gives this factor of 3 about uncertainty on the upper value of the effective Majorana mass. The predictions for the from the three neutrino mixing paradigm, we can do some prediction of what we expect to observe in a similar way to what I have done for the neutrino masses and also for the effective mass in the beta decay. So what we can do is to consider as a free parameter the lightest mass in the normal ordering, which is M1, and the inverted ordering, which is M3, and study what is the what are the possibilities for this effective Majorana mass. So you can see here in the case of the normal ordering, here I have plotted the allowed values for the three masses times the corresponding element of the mixing matrix. So if we start here, you can see that the effect of new twist dominating. So you cannot have cancellations between this contribution and the other two, and you can obtain a range for the effective Majorana mass. But if you go here in this region, the order of magnitude of the three is similar, and you can have cancellation among them if these phases are unfavorable, as I showed before. So in this region, there is no lower limit for the effective Majorana mass, which can be even zero. You can have a perfect cancellation among the three contributions. And this is the worst scenario for this, for the experimentalists which are looking for this process. If you go in the quasi-degenerate region, then the new one is dominating, and again, you don't have a, you cannot have a perfect cancellations. And in any case, you can see that even when one is dominating, there is a large uncertainty because we don't know the phases. So the phases, in any case, can cause some partial cancellation. This is in the case of non-normal ordering. In the case of inverted ordering, the situation is much better because here the new one is always dominating. So there cannot be perfect cancellations, and for any value of this lightest mass, you get some finite value of the effective mass, which can be observed by the experiments. So now the next, the experiments which are under construction and the next generation of experiments will try to explore this range of corresponding to the inverted hierarchy. At the moment, the current bound is at this level, so it is in the quasi-degenerate region. But this is a very active field, and it is important that the experiment will test, will find, try to find this neutrinoless double beta decay. Okay, I think that I can finish this for the phenomenological part and move to neutrinos in cosmology. How do I exit this? Can I exit? So I need to open a new file. It was easy. Yes, this one. Okay, so now let me discuss the neutrinos in cosmology. And just to start, I just presented this plot that maybe you have seen before. This plot shows more or less the evolution of the universe. And what we will discuss is the at the beginning is the decoupling of the neutrinos. So this is the cosmic neutrino, the creation of the cosmic neutrino background, which produces the current relic neutrinos. And these neutrinos are were decoupled at the temperature, as we will see, at the temperature of about 1 MeV. Which happens just shortly before Big Bang nucleosynthesis and much earlier than the recombination time in which the cosmic microwave background radiation was formed. So first I have some slides in which I establish my notation, so and the, also the framework that I work. So I will work in the, consider the standard cosmological scenario, so standard Big Bang with inflation and nothing, no other unusual, more exotic effects. So I will, so this is just the Einstein equation. I will consider the, this is the standard energy momentum tensor. I will consider this metric in which here I only want to note that I use this R instead of A that Robert was using. So R is a dimension, a quantity with a dimension which can be thought as the radius of a closed universe. In any case, it is a, some scale quantity, and we don't need to know what is its value because all the observable quantities depend on ratio of R at two different times. And what Robert and others used, this A was, is simply R over R0. So it's just a different convention. Then what is important is the Friedman equation, which give the rate of the expansion of the universe. So relate the Hubble rate to the energy density. And this is the curvature term, and the Hubble rate is given by this equation. What is important, an important quantity is the redshift, because all the quantities in the past depend on the redshift. Can be quantified in terms of the redshift, and the redshift is given by the variation of the wavelength with respect to the observation. So this is the index zero means always what the current time. So this is the wavelength at the current time with respect to the wavelength at the time of the emission. From the expansion of the universe, it's easy to find that 1 plus z is given by r over r at the current time divided by r at the time of the emission. I will consider these three sources of energy: radiation, matter, and the vacuum energy. As you heard also in previous lecture, they have a different equation of states. So this coefficient W is 1/3 for the radiation, 0 for matter, and -1 for the vacuum energy. So this means that during the expansion of the universe, these densities evolve in a different way. So radiation evolves as r to the -4, and this means 1 plus z to the 4. Matter is r to the -3, and this is 1 plus z to the third, and the rho is constant. I will consider in the following a flat universe, and the universe is flat when k is equal to 0, and this defines the critical density. The critical density is given by this equation, and it's usually convenient to express it in terms of this lowercase h. So the lowercase h is the Hubble constant in units of 100 kilometers per second per megaparsecs. And this is because we know that h is about 0.7, but there are some uncertainty on the value of this h. So this h is a quantity which is determined by the fit of cosmological data. It is also useful to define the capital omegas, which are the ratios of the three different types of energies with respect to the critical density, and the sum of the three is equal to 1 in the flat universe. So I will consider a flat universe because we have a rather strong indication that the universe is very close to be flat. This is a plot that you have already seen, so this is just to show that since we know that now the vacuum energy is dominating, if you go backward in time, so when r was smaller, then we have now we have a domination of vacuum energy, then we had a time in which matter was dominating, and earlier the radiation domination. And it is this is important to take note of these two important times, or r. This is the matter equality r time, and this is the time of equality of matter and the vacuum energy. It is also useful to calculate the variation of the expansion rate as a function of z. And this can be done easily by what is the contribution of the different form of energies. This can be done easily by considering the Friedmann equation for a flat universe, and by dividing it by the Friedmann equation at the current time. So this gives this expression. And here we can substitute for the different energy densities, their value at the current times times the function of the redshift that gives the revolution during the expansion of the universe. So we can do that, and then we have here the ratio of the omegas at the current moment. So zero means the current moment. So this gives this expression for the expansion rate, which depends on the current value of the expansion rate, which is the depends on the Hubble constant, what is called the Hubble constant, and but it depends also on the different amounts of vacuum energy, matter, and radiation today. So the, this determines completely the evolution of the expansion rate at earlier times. Then we need also to introduce the thermodynamics of the particles in the primordial plasma. So these particles in the primordial plasma, there were a lot of interaction which keep into equilibrium the particles. So we can apply the statistical mechanics. And these three equations give the values for the number density, the energy density, and the pressure density. And these are depends on the statistical distribution here, which is different from fermions and bosons. So for fermions is plus, for boson is minus. Here we have the energy, which depend on the momentum. And here the integral is over the momentum. We have also the chemical potential that I will not use it, so I'm not going now to describe what it is. Notice here that all these are proportional to G, which is the number of degrees of freedom, that is the number of spin state of each particle. So here chi is the generic particle. It is useful to consider the relativistic limit. So the relativistic limit is when the temperature is much larger than the mass of the particle, and also much larger than the kinetical potential, the chemical potential. And then in this case, the distribution assumes this form, and one can make the integrations. So the result is that given here by these equations here, I will just point out what you need to remember about this equation. So these equations, what one needs to remember is that the number density, both for boson and fermions, depends as the temperature to the third power, and the energy density depends of the temperature to the fourth power, both for boson and for fermions. And then you have always this coefficient G, which give the number of degrees of freedom. And you can notice, it's important to notice this factor 7 to 8, which distinguish the fermions for the boson. So for the fermions, there is an additional factor 7 to 8 for the density. And for radiation, this is the standard relation for the equation of state of radiation. One can also calculate what is the average energy, which is given by these two expressions for boson and for fermions. It is proportional to the temperature, and one just need to remember that for both, it is about three times the temperature, just for some order of magnitude estimation. Yes.
Once
died before. No, this this is the exact one. This is for the relativistic case. So you can see in the relativistic case here I have momentum, but and no chemical. Yes, because I assume this. So there are two differences: no chemical potential, so it's negligible the chemical potential, and also the mass is negligible. So you you don't have energy here, but the absolute value of the momentum, which allows you to do the integrations. If you have the mass, you cannot do the integration analytically. Oh, no. Here we are talking about temperatures above the bigger than the mass of each particle. So for each particle, it depends. So as we will see for neutrinos, we will consider the case when neutrinos are ultra-relativistic. So in this approximation applies. So, and here we are talking about a temperature of like 10 millielectron volts. So, for a temperature before higher than 10 millielectron volts, neutrinos are ultra-relativistic, and below they are non-relativistic. For other particles, for example, we will discuss also electron-proton annihilation when the electrons become non-relativistic. So this happened at a temperature of about half MeV. Okay, then just I want only to note that just from the fact that we found that from the beginning, we know that radiation energy density is scaling as r to the minus 4, and we just found here that radiation depends on the temperature to the fourth. So by putting these two things together, we find that we can find that temperature in a equilibrium. So when you have a plasma and you have some equilibrium plasma, the temperature is scaling as r to the minus 1. So that is why the universe cools during the expansion as r to the minus 1. Now, so let us discuss neutrino decoupling. So before, at a very high temperature, neutrinos were kept in thermal equilibrium with the other particles to these reactions. So these are reactions of neutrinos with the electrons, which are in the plasma, and also with the nucleons, and also all these reactions. These reactions, but the universe is expanding, so the temperature is decreasing, and the rate of the reaction depends on the temperature. So the higher is the temperature, the higher is the rate of the reaction. If you have the universe which is cooling, at some point you reach a temperature in which the rate of the reaction is not sufficient to keep the neutrinos in thermal equilibrium. And then you have the neutrino decoupling. And you have this situation when the rate of the reaction is smaller than the Hubble expansion rate. So in that case, practically the free path of a neutrino is larger than the Hubble radius, and this means that neutrinos do not interact anymore and they are decoupled. So in order to find the condition, when this happened, we need to calculate the rate of the reactions. Here, the precise calculation of the rate of the reactions is a complicated process, but we can have an estimation of the rate of the reaction with simpler dimensional arguments. So the rate of the reaction must be proportional to the number density of the neutrinos times the cross-section times the velocity, average value of the cross-section times the velocity of the neutrinos. And we know that the number density is proportional to the temperature to the cube. The cross-sections, just by dimensional argument, these are weak interaction cross-sections, so this is must be proportional to GF squared times time to the square. And the velocity is 1, because the neutrinos are ultra-relativistic, so one can find that the interaction rate is proportional to the temperature to the fifth power. Then we need to calculate the expansion rate. To do that, we use the Friedmann equation. And since we are in the radiation-dominated area, we can consider only the energy density of radiation, which is dominating. We can neglect the other energy densities. The energy density of radiation is given by this expression. So you remember it's proportional to the temperature to the fourth, and then you have some coefficient which takes into account of how many degrees of freedom you have. And to calculate this G star, you need to sum over all the relativistic bosons and the relativistic fermions that are that are present at the time. So before neutrino decoupling, the what we have is in the plasma, the relativistic particles in the plasma are photons, electrons, and neutrinos. And the photons contribute as two. The fermions have this factor 7-8 that I noticed before. And for the electrons, we have 4 degrees of freedom because we have electron positron and positive and negative helicity. For the neutrinos, we have, for each species of neutrino, we have only 2 degrees of freedom because we have left-handed neutrinos and right-handed neutrinos. And 2 times 3 generation, we get 6. So the exact number of this G star is 10.75. And this we can use here for the calculation of the Hubble rate. So if one then equates the interaction rate to the Hubble rate, one finds that the temperature at which this you have this equality, so you have the neutrino decoupling, is of the order of 1 MeV. This is just a rat calculation. One can do a better calculation by calculating precisely all the interactions. In this case, one finds that the dominant interactions are the interactions of the neutrino with the electrons that are in thermal equilibrium. And this is important because the interaction of the electron neutrino is different from the interaction of the mu and tau neutrinos with the electrons. So for the mu and tau neutrinos, you can have only neutral current interaction with the electrons, which are given by this diagram. You can have them also for electron neutrinos and antineutrinos. But for electron neutrinos and antineutrinos, you can also have some these two type of charge current interactions. So the electron neutrinos and antineutrinos, they are more, they interact strongly, and this means that they are kept in equilibrium with the plasma for a longer time, so their temperature of decoupling will be lower than the temperature of decoupling of the mu and tau neutrino. And a precise calculation, given the fact that the temperature here is smaller for the electron neutrino and for the mu and the tau neutrino. Moreover, there is also a dependence on the momentum because the so we have a neutrinos have an energy distribution, so a momentum distribution. This is the Fermi-Dirac distribution, and the cross sections depend on the neutrino momentum. So one can write the decoupling is not instantaneous for all the neutrino distribution, but it is happens at different temperature for the different neutrino momentum. Usually, one considers the average energy as a standard value to quantify the decoupling temperature, and this you remember is about 3 times the temperature. So it turns out that electron neutrino decouple at about 1.9 MeV. And the mu and tau neutrino decouple at about 3.1 MeV. Now, after decoupling, neutrinos do not interact anymore, so their distribution cannot change, so the shape of the distribution cannot change, and the shape of the distribution is the Fermi-Dirac distribution like here. So we can calculate from here how the temperature of the neutrino evolves after that. This can be done by just imposing that the shape of the distribution after decoupling is the same as the shape of the distribution at decoupling, and taking into account that the momentum is decreasing according to r to the minus 1. This is according to the expansion of the universe. So if one puts everything together, one can write the distribution at any time after the decoupling in the same way as a Fermi-Dirac distribution, but with a temperature which decreases as r to the minus 1. Now we need this is the relation that this gives the temperature of the neutrino, but we want to find what is the relation of the temperature to the neutrino, which we cannot measure because the Rayleigh neutrino so far has not been observed. We want to find what is the relation of the temperature of the neutrinos with the temperature of the photons, which is measured. It's 2.7 Kelvin. To find that, it is necessary to take into account electron-positron annihilation, because this is a process which happens after neutrino decoupling, because the electron has a mass of about 0.5 MeV, and we have seen that neutrino decoupling occurs at around 1 or some MeV. After neutrino decoupling at a temperature of about t times smaller than the mass of the electron, we have this electron-positron annihilation, and the electron-positron annihilates into photons. This reaction before electron-positron annihilation was in equilibrium, so there was as many electron annihilating as photon creating electron, but after at a smaller temperature, this reaction goes out of equilibrium, so there are the photons had not any more energy to create electron positron, and all the electron positron annihilate into the photons. During this phase, the proton temperature does not scale as r to the minus 1, so this scaling of the temperatures as r to the minus 1 happens only when there are not such type of processes. So when the universe is expanding without any change, transfer of entropy from some particle to the other. So here we have a transfer of entropy from the electrons to the photons. Entropy is important because although there is this transfer of the entropy, the total entropy is must be conserved because the expansion is adiabatic. So using the fact that the total entropy is conserved, we can find the relation between the neutrino energy and the photon energies, as we see now. So this is the entropy density, which is, can be written as rho plus p divided by t. So this is proportional to the temperature to the cube. And the coefficient is Gs, which is another coefficient which looks similar to the G star that I introduced before, but it is different because in G star I counted all the relativistic particles independently if they were in equilibrium or not. Gs instead quantifies the entropy, so counts only the particles which are in equilibrium. So here we must add the bosons and the fermions, only those that are in equilibrium. And total entropy conservation, so since this is the entropy density, total entropy conservation implies that S must vary as r to the minus 3. So you can see that then this implies that the photon temperature, when there is some annihilation process, so some transfer of entropy, does not change as r to the minus 1, but changes also according to this Gs factor, which changes when there is this annihilation process. So now to find what is the temperature of the neutrino with respect to the temperature to the photon after the decoupling, we can use these relations. So this is the relation of the temperature of neutrino after and the temperature of neutrino before. This is just the ratio of the R quantities to the minus 1, because neutrinos are not heated by the photon. So their temperature just continues to vary as R to the minus 1. Instead, for the photons, we have to take into account this additional contribution. And this additional contribution is quantified here, so we need to know what is Gs before and after this annihilation. Gs before is given by just the GS of the photon plus the GS of the electron, which are in thermal equilibrium before electron-positron annihilation. So the this is given by 2 plus 7, 8, 4, and it is 11, 12. After, the electrons are not anymore in equilibrium, so the GS is simply given only by the photon. Now, taking into account that the temperature of neutrino and photons before electron-positron annihilation was the same, we can find this, putting all together, we find this relation between the temperature of the neutrino and the temperature of the photon, and it is this coefficient for 11 over 11 to the 1/3. This is a number which is slightly smaller than 1, so it's about 0.7. So it means that after electron-positron annihilation, the temperature of the neutrino is smaller, obviously because, as is shown by this graph, the photon temperature was increased by the electron-positron annihilation. We can then, using this relation, we know what is the current temperature of the relic neutrinos, and this is about 1.9 Kelvin, which correspond to about 1.6 times 10 to the minus 4 electron volt. And here I go back to what I said just in the beginning of the lecture. You remember that I show you this plot in which we know that at least two neutrinos are massive and they have a mass of larger than about 8 millielectron volt, and this mass is larger than this temperature. So it means that at least two neutrinos of the two species of neutrinos are non-relativistic in the relic neutrino background. Now, in the analysis of cosmological data, it is useful to consider the total density of radiation at the time of matter-radiation equality. So, and this is much after the neutrino decoupling, much after electron-positron annihilation. So the contribution of the neutrinos to this total energy density is given by this factor 4 over 11 to the 4/3. Because now we have a power 4, because this is proportional to the temperature to the 4th. And then there is the effective number of neutrinos, which is 3 naively, but as you see here, it is slightly larger than 3, and now I am going to explain why. But before going that, let me only remark that this is a rather general expression for the radiation density, which in which we have the photon contribution, which is the 1, and then we have some fermion contribution here. And usually, in the standard cosmological scenario, there are only 3 neutrinos, but we can have also some additional particles and some more exotic particles, they can also contribute to this effective number of degrees of freedom. So sometimes it's called effective number of neutrinos, but the more correct terminology is the effective number of degrees of freedom, relativistic degrees of freedom. So now I'm going to discuss why this value is not 3, but is slightly larger than 3. And this is a complicated thing, because the problem is that so far I just assumed implicitly that a neutrino decoupling is instantaneous, but it is not instantaneous, and in fact we have already seen that the time of decoupling depends on the neutrino energy, and so the higher energy neutrinos, which interact stronger, they decouple later. And it means that the tail of the Fermi-Dirac distribution, which contains the higher energy neutrinos, is not decoupled at the time of electron-photon annihilation. And then electron photons, when they annihilate, they mostly transfer the entropy to the to the photons, but there is also some contribution to the neutrino. So some high energy neutrinos are heated by the electron photon annihilation. Here we must take into account on the same diagram that I showed before and on the fact that the electron and neutrino and antineutrino interact strongly than the muon and tau neutrino. So this effect will be larger for the electron neutrinos than the muon and tau neutrinos. How one can study this? This is a complicated calculation, and it must be done numerically. So what the people do is to consider the equilibrium distribution and to parameterize this effect to a distortion of the spectrum, which is a non-thermal distortion. So this fact that the decoupling is not instantaneous will cause a distortion in the Fermi-Dirac distribution, because only the higher energy tail of the distribution is affected by this process. So you don't, the exact distribution after the electron positron annihilation it will not be an exact Fermi-Dirac, but it will have a correction that one can calculate. The calculation of this correction is a difficult process. One must solve the Boltzmann equation, which gives the evolution of the distribution as a function of time, taking into account of the expansion of the universe, and here taking into account of all the interactions. So here there is a very complicated interaction term that I'm not going to discuss. I'm going to give you only the result. So the result is shown in this in this plot here. So in this plot, they use some unusual quantity here for the x-axis. So they use this x, which is ma times r. R, by definition, is temperature to the minus 1. And x is the product of this r times the mass of the electron. So the x is the ratio between the mass of the electron and the temperature. So as the temperature decreases, x increases. Then one must do also this calculation for a definite value of the neutrino momentum. And this they use. So y is the momentum divided by the temperature. So this calculation is done for a value of y equal to 10. And so as you can see that as the universe cools, the temperature of the photons increases because of electron positron annihilation, and there is some distortion to the. So this is the ratio of the true distribution with respect to the equilibrium distribution. So there is a distortion of the distribution, which depends on the type of the neutrino. So for it is larger for the electron neutrino, as I said before, because electron neutrinos are the ones that interact more strongly. And it is smaller for the mu and tau neutrino, as given by the green curve, which is obtained in the case of no oscillations. Here, the situation is more very complicated, because if you want to do an exact calculation, you need to take into account also neutrino oscillations. And neutrino oscillations, moreover, are affected by the matter effect. So this is difficult to understand. I will try just to give you some illustration of what happens. So neutrino oscillation can occur in the early universe between different flavor of neutrinos, and these oscillations can happen when the matter effect is not too strong. So if the matter effect is too strong, then the oscillations are suppressed. And the matter effect depends on the density of the universe, and in particular it depends on the number density of the charged electrons, because these are the ones that produce this matter effect. So the interaction of the not interaction, but the potential which is felt by the neutrino in the background of charged leptons is the matter effect. And so the matter effect depends on the number density of leptons. So this will be electron or at higher energy muons. This is a positron or antimuons. This is the usually is considered to be the dominant term, but you can see that here there is a minus sign. And in the early universe, the matter-antimatter asymmetry was very small, was of the order of 10 to the minus 10. So this is a term which is the dominant case, for example, for a solar neutrino, is negligible. It's very small for the in the early universe because of this very small matter-antimatter asymmetry. And there is a contribution of a higher order term, which is just proportional to the sum of the densities of leptons and antileptons. This is higher order because this coefficient is smaller than this one because there is a mass of the W squared at the denominator. But there is some possibility to, but well, it must be proportional to GF and to the. Why the difference? Because the signs can change. So when you go from particle to antiparticle, the potential can change sign. So this is can be derived from. So maybe more, this is more difficult to understand why there is a plus here. So I think this is natural because when you change particle into antiparticle, you expect that you change the sign. This is more difficult to understand, in my opinion. so this plot show what happens as a function of the decreasing temperature. So if you go to the higher temperature here, and so what you need is that the oscillation contribution must be larger than the matter effect in order to have the oscillations. And this is the oscillation contribution due to the atmospheric delta M square, and this is for the solar delta M square. If you start at a temperature about 30 MeV here, the oscillation contribution is smaller than the potential due to the muon, anti-muon that are still present in the plasma. So these transitions are suppressed and they start to operate only at a temperature smaller than 30 MeV, so in this region. And then at this point, the electron transition into mu and tau neutrino due to the atmospheric delta M square can start to operate, and they could not before because the contribution of the potential of the electron was too large. And at this point here, you have also this transition to the solar delta M square. So all these type of things are taken into account in this calculation. And the result is that, I just finished with this slide. And the result is that you have a contribution from neutrino oscillations, which depend also on the precise value of the elements of the mixing matrix that you need to know. So for example, for theta 1,3 is equal to zero, you get the red lines. This is for the electron and this is for mu and tau. And for the theta 1,3 different from zero, you get the blue lines. So this is the most realistic realistic case. So the result of all that is that you can calculate, it's possible to calculate what are these delta, these distortions of the distribution with respect to the equilibrium distribution. And the effective number of degrees of freedom is given by 3 plus the sum of these 3 distortions. And this is where you get this 0.46 that is different from. Okay, I stop here. Thank you.
questions?
The theory of decoupling of neutrinos is 1 MeV, you said.
About one order of magnitude, but we have seen that it is two for the electron and three for the.
But you mentioned in the slide a temperature of 100 MeVs in one slide there before. When you talk about that, I didn't understand it. When you talk about.
I don't remember which slide it was.
When we're talking about decoupling of neutrinos.
Decoupling of
the neutrinos. We estimated that, and then you mentioned a temperature. I did hear. A more precise heuristic is about the dominant process.
Because here we assume that this decoupling happens at the temperature below 100 MeV. And after we find that it is true, so everything is consistent. If the decoupling happened at larger temperatures, then we have to consider also muons.
Okay, so I actually have a question of my own, but I'll postpone it so we can keep on schedule.
Okay.
So let's thank the speaker again. And the next speaker is Mario Novello. He's going to talk about mass generation.
Não, mas eu vou.
Se, você abre.
Se eu abrir aqui, já sai lá?
Já.
Vou esperar um pouquinho. Mais cima, pode ficar mais em cima. João, tá funcionando? Tá, né? Ok. I realized that in this school of 2010, there was already a review on the problem of mechanism of formation of mass due to gravitation. So everybody who is really interested on this subject should take this cosmology and gravitation that is the Brazilian School of Cosmology 2010, okay? I'll talk, in any case, I'll talk about something related to this. But essentially, I'll try to show that there is an intimate relation, at least for the case of which I explained here, vector fields between the mass and the cosmological constant. The standard mechanism of mass generation, which is so-called Higgs mechanism, which was made by Brout, Engler, and others, concerns a scalar field, the Higgs field. And these scalar fields, in order to give mass, is such that its corresponding energy momentum tensor is a constant times G mini. In the beautiful lecture of Zumino in the CERN lectures in the 60s, he shows that although this resembles very much a cosmological constant, there is no way to introduce gravity to discuss the problem of mechanism of generation of mass once gravity is a very weak process. I'll try to convince you in these lectures, which I gave already on the intensity of the gravitational field, nor on the cosmological constant. In a sense, gravity enters only as a catalyst process, as I will show just now. although, of course, there are other questions concerning this make. But here I'll try to just to show that there is an intimate connection, which was already put out by Ernest Mach 100 years ago. And the way I will show this is very similar to what people in the scalar field theory in gravity calls the modification of the Einstein frame to Jordan frame. In a sense, you have a map, a conformal map, and if you consider that you have minimal coupling in this representation, this minimal coupling changes by a conformal transformation. The theory is the same, just the representation are different. By other terms, which are nothing but a scalar field interaction relate to this omega field. Let us see how we can do this in the framework of vector fields. First of all, let me introduce you also to a beautiful idea of Dirac, which in the 50s considered a choice of gauge, which he using this quantity. Which was used classically by Dirac to define, in the case this quantity is positive, some sort of cosmological time. Later on, Nambu discussed its quantum properties and the possibility to deal with a dynamical process concerning this quantity phi. Okay, so let us start supposing that you have a Lagrangian. I will talk about the action. And I will consider the first step approach in which you have, let us put here my notes. Maxwell term plus the standard. I'll put here C square. I'll put C and K equal to 1 afterwards. R plus a function of phi times R. And just in order to avoid difficulties with this term, I'll put another term like this. Note that once phi is not really a scalar because, for instance, in a conformal mapping, one expects that a scalar changes like this. And here you see that this phi changes as omega minus 2. Phi. So it's not really a scalar, although considering from the point of view of coordinates, it's a scalar. So I'll take this Lagrangian, which is, seems very unusual one, and which immediately brooks the gauge invariance, and see what happens with the dynamics of this, including gravitational dynamics. I never used this, but once, une fois c'est pas coutume, comme on dit les Français, I will show to you. Non fonctionne, claro. Premier slide. Posso fazer aqui? Okay. So the equation of of the field is a very complicated one, as you can see. The equation of G mini is also a little complicated. But if you take the trace of this equation of G mini, if you take the trace of this G mini and you substitute there, in the case we have only this action, then you have the strange result that this can become zero if we choose V and H in this way, which is written here, phi minus 3, 1 over phi. Now, on the other way, if I put here a term of mass, this equation changes by just putting here something which is a constant times T times Me equal to zero. In case T is a constant, this exactly resembles a mass term. When this Lagrangian here is just the cosmological constant, it will be exactly a term, a constant. T is a constant, but it's not necessary to be a cosmological constant, because if you have any energy momentum tensor which has the trace is a constant by chance or by properties of the energy momentum tensor, then you have this expression. But let us work a little more with this action and see, first of all, let us, instead of using this variable Ame, phi, let us use the variable z defined like 6, 1 plus 5. If you use this variable, then this Lagrangian, the action, becomes in a way which, você diz que eu posso pegar aqui assim? Ah, good. The Lagrangian becomes this one, which is very similar, minus 1, 4, F, Maxwell's term, and the two terms which resembles a scalar field, Z. Remember that it's not really a scalar field, conformally coupled to gravity. So this property of this, I made nothing. I just redefine the function, which does not change nothing in the dynamics. This allow us to think in another possibility. Consider, for instance, Maxwell Einstein Lagrangian, and make a conformal transformation, but such that you choose the conformal transformation as a function of the phi, of the norm. If you choose this, then this is true. If you choose this, then you see that there is a map from G mini to G tilde mini, in which Lagrangian of Einstein Feynman, Einstein Maxwell. Of course, I'm just saying that F is equal to F mini, F mini, becomes precisely this kind of Lagrangian which you are considering prior. In other words, this Lagrangian here, which you start with this choice of a potential V and H, becomes conformally related to this standard Lagrangian. So there is a standard connection between the Einstein-Maxwell Lagrangian and its conformal representation, which I call this representation the Dirac representation, and this the Maxwell, let's say Maxwell Einstein, and this should be, let's say, Dirac representation. That means the dynamics are precisely the same. I'm just making a conformal transformation, which obviously you know the properties G tilde mini omega squared G mini, which implies square root of mu G tau is omega 4 square root of mu G. That's why I connect this Lagrangian with this one which we had before. But this term in the Lagrangian, now I introduce a cosmological term, for instance. We add to this dynamics here. I introduce a cosmological term. What happens in the other representation? You see? You introduce in the G tilde metric this cosmological term in terms of this conformal transformation concerning 1 minus phi is the map concerning omega, which we just put there. And in the Einstein-Maxwell representation, it becomes precisely as a mass term plus self-interacting term. That means introducing a cosmological term in this conformal representation implies a mass term in the standard or in the G-mini metric. It is more or less simple to see that due to the symmetry of these equations, you can do the inverse operation. That means you can consider that, let's see if I write this here. Yes, this is the, this is not important for this moment. You see, if I introduce, let us rephrase what I'm saying. We have this Lagrangian. We make a conformal transformation, G tilde mini, and you go to a Lagrangian, which is the same dynamic as there, minus 4 F, actually, I have put here square root of mu g, and I have to put here square root of mu g l in terms of square root mu g tau times minus 1/4 f tilde, which is f. Well, let's put f tilde, because otherwise, plus r plus z tilde square 1 over 6 minus z tilde alpha These are two representations, as is done in the scalar field theory, making now in the case of vector fields. Now, what we have shown is that if you introduce here a mass term, let's say a cosmological constant, the effect of here is to introduce a mass term plus a self-interaction of the field. And vice versa. That means if I introduce here a cosmological constant, then the net effect is that this term here has a mass plus some self-interaction. With this simple exercise, we have understood the idea of Mach to connect mass to something which should be the cosmological constant, but not necessarily. Because, you see, all this structure becomes, because one should say, well, this is just the problem of identifying mass of particles with cosmological constant, which is the value which we know, which has nothing to do with the mass of the particles. But no, it's not the case because, you see, as we have seen before, the introduction here of this term makes really the effect of the trace of the momentum, of the energy momentum tensor of the matter. The lambda is just a particular case in which the trace is a constant. That means this case is a particular case, but what is behind here is the fact that the mass is related to the fact that you have the trace of the energy momentum tensor is constant. So, you see, there is no interaction, direct interaction, unless by gravity, between matter and the field. It's a very different, distinct case of, for instance, mechanism of the Higgs and other mechanisms in which you should have a direct interaction between the field that generates mass and the field which gain mass. Here it's not the case because the connection between the particle which gives mass, the object which gives mass, is any kind of matter, but in this case particular should have its trace constant. It's clear that this mechanism is not a general one, but it can be generalized almost directly. This generalization was made in two papers which are completely ignored by the high energy physics community. One in classical and quantum gravity. And in Physical Review, D86063510, 2012. I was a little astonished that Physical Review accept this paper, but perhaps the referee was a little absent, because here it's shown that there is no need to introduce an extra field, which exists, of course, the Higgs field, to give mass to the particle. Actually, to give mass to particles, you need at least two properties. One, this field should be universal. That means it should interact with everything that exists. And second, there is a state in which this field is precisely assumes this kind of particular situation. Well, we know that there exists gravity, which is universal, and which solves the first requirement. That means it's universal, it comes with everything. And second, in this particular case here, in which I gave to you, it's not a general one. For fermions, it's a little different, and so on and so, but it's written in these papers. But in any case, the fact that you have a state in which the field behaves as the cosmological constant time Gemini is a very common one. For instance, it's true that it's difficult to have a situation in which, for instance, Maxwell theory becomes, in this way, a cosmological constant. But suppose you have any Lagrangian of this phi. That means, let's consider a field, F mean E, it's a vector field, which is nonlinear. So it satisfies this equation, in which LF is derivative with respect to F. I'm using only the invariant F to simplify. It can be generalized, of course, of the other invariant. Then it's most simple to show that it's possible to have a constant, Gemini, for a physical situation with this field. And the reason is very simple, because the only the case L is linear, the energy momentum tensor becomes the simple one, like this. When you have terms which depends non-linear on F, then the energy momentum tensor is much more involved. And it's almost simple to show that this is a state in which it happens. This is just to show that there are plenty of times, of ways, to provide from non-linear theories situations in which you arrive at this case. The Higgs mechanism is one particular case in which you have a nonlinear interaction, because theory should be nonlinear, and that you have exactly a situation in which the energy momentum tensor is a constant time Gemini. I remember when I asked somebody, I don't remember who, or why Zumino, in this beautiful lecture notes on CERN in the 60s or 70s, I remember, but said that because you see, in the standard Higgs mechanism, you have terms which exactly have this property, and it's obvious that this property here should change the metric. But it's complete nonsense to consider these terms changing in the laboratory experiment. This is obvious from everybody. But what I'm claiming that this property here, which is much more common in nonlinear theories than usually people consider, is the basic one to examine some sort of structure like this one here, which I show only to case of vector fields, to show that it's possible that gives mass. In the case I presented here, it's only the trace of the energy momentum tensor that should be constant. Quanto tempo, sir? Okay. Okay, let us make Now, for the case of the gauge non-invariant properties, you see that if you make this a gauge transformation in which phi, which is a mi, goes to phi primo for when a mi goes to a mi prime, a mi plus d mi lambda, d mi, let's say, key, the phi goes to phi plus twice a mi key, the mi plus key mi square. The phi changes under this way. But if you make now a conformal transformation, then the gauge phi going phi prime implies a conformal map in order g tilde mini goes to g prime mini. G prime mini represents the same dynamics. Why this could be? Well, it's simple, because you see, you have here Maxwell term plus Einstein term. Let us suppose here. This theory is gauge invariant under this transformation. This theory here certainly is not gauge invariant because you have a function of phi. But the point is that, remember, that the g tilde mini is also has inside it this function phi. So in such a way that this coupling, although this explicit expression does not has gauge invariant, it is conformally related to this theory, which is conformal, which is gauge invariant. So gauge invariant changes only for another map of this kind. And once you have a gauge transformation, what you do is precisely make a second conformal transformation, which implies that this dynamics goes to this, which are related to the previous one by a conformal transformation also. So this makes the problem of non-explicit gauge invariance of this theory less complicated, I hope. Finally, okay, no, let's stop here.
Questions? I have a question.
I also have a question.
Okay, so your phi field should be in between minus 1 and plus 1, right? Because otherwise your h won't be defined.
This is a scalar field, no? But phi is not a scalar field.
Well, that
would... In the sense that at the conformal transformation, it transforms as the norm of a vector, right, which does not change.
Okay, but it's still, there is a, it has dynamics, right?
The phi field?
Yes. So it will always be in between minus 1 and plus 1? Because if it reaches minus 1, then your h, which is minus 3 over 1 plus
this
5,
blows
up, and your z is not defined.
Yeah, exactly. There are some restrictions on this case, yes.
Okay.
Well, actually, Dirac choose phi equal to 1. Because he would like to have this phi, this a mi and mi, to be cosmological time. But it's not completely necessary. Here it's a dynamic object which has some constraints. Yes,
yeah, because if it's
right.
1, then your z is not
of
defined.
Course, yes.
Then you cannot do. Okay. And the first Lagrangian that you wrote, that you have, where you have the v and h and all that, it looked like Brunswick. But it's not.
This
right?
One?
Yeah, the one at the top.
Yes.
The first line. It looked like Brunsdick when you make that that definition by V equals phi, but it's not, because phi is actually has a dynamics coming from F. Is that right?
Exactly. It looks like that's why, in a sense, I discovered that what I'm doing is precisely what you people from Scala Field do concerning Jordan Brunsdick representations or frames. Yes, that's why I saw that this is some sort of changing frames in the sense of using Scala Field. Yes. I never saw this made. Everybody, someone has saw this transformation.
You mean for vector fields?
Like for vector fields. It's very stunning because it's too simple. You start with the Einstein-Maxwell, and you make a conformal transformation. But you choose the conformal map as a function of the object, which is the norm of the vector field. That's only the trick. The trick is only this, because otherwise it's trivial. You see? This theory is not conformal invariant, of course, but you can impose that the representation are the same, and you make just a conformal map, but a special one, which depends on this. And there is this curious property. And for me, what's interesting on this, beside this, let's say, semantic question, is the fact that the matter interacts through exactly this gauge brick in turn, which is precisely some sort of mass indicates the trace is a constant.
So my final question is, matter will follow geodesics on which metric? The first one?
Matter?
Yes. So assume that you have a matter Lagrangian.
If you
right?
put matter Lagrangian here.
Yes, from the beginning.
And
yes.
if you make a conformal transformation, the matter depends on the what are the Lagrangian you put here.
Oh, yes.
Here you put, of course, it follows geodesics. Right. This is standard Einstein-Maxwell theory. Standard. And the conformal, as you know, the same situation occurs in Scala Field, yes. something like this. So it's not not different.
Any further questions? Yes.
Only the chairman asks question. Is politesse, come on, dit.
No, it's not.
Okay.
Okay, so let's thank Mario again.
Okay, thank you.
And so we'll be back at 2 sharp, please.
And remember that this evening, you have at 5 o'clock, there will be a small comment on the BSG by authorities. Then you have a singer with Italian songs. And then after, you have some welcome drinks and, okay?
And everything
snacks.
Here.
Vamos. Diga, amanhã vamos tirar foto. Avisa.
Okay, so tomorrow is going to have the picture from the school. So be here, right?